Watch this video with our virtual reality glasses for smartphone. Virtualvisor.com.
You can actually.
That's not intimidating at all.
You can actually move around experiences, just like you would do in real life. So, in real life, if I wanted to do this to Caitlin, I could, right? And that's real reality, I can do that. I can also do that if she was a virtual character and I was a virtual character, and we were interacting in virtual space together, which allows us to sort of work on the idea of socialization in VR and how we tell stories differently in this medium than we can in the traditional forms of cinema, which I think is really intriguing, and I think people that are starting to dabble in this subject matter tend to lean backward into the art form of the past, and people that are very forward-leaning tend to look forward into the art forms of the future, with one very interesting exception, that is theme park logic, which is where you come from. And in my mind, the original sort of art of virtual reality was created in the world of theme parks, where it's spatial, where you actually get to walk around things, and they put you in vehicles to move you around in space. So when you go into the Haunted Mansion, you move through the Haunted Mansion. When you go into the Pirates of the Caribbean, everybody probably knows this moment where you see that pirate's leg, and it's dangling over the bridge, and as you get closer and closer to it spatially, because you're moving physically in a boat, you see that that leg has actual hairs on it, and you kind of go, oh wow, that looks like a real leg. And that's, to me, the fundamental difference of what we're building and taking out to a very wide swath of people now that we can commercialize and modernize this technology. So that's where the spatial sense is.
Can I add something to that, Phil? You know, so one of the things you said about that, you know, about the kind of the, a change in the way we think about our ability to inhabit space and that we can do this,
yep.
I think the biggest part of what you just did and demonstrated isn't about our ability to change how we experience space, but it's how we experience agency.
Right.
It's the choice to do that, right? Which is not something that we have today in most narrative, you know, broadcast media, right? We don't have that sense of inhabiting a sense of agency or being able to have that sense of agency, which evolving platforms are going to allow us to do. To me, that's the key part, is about being able to exercise the decision and then the follow through of changing my point of view.
Yeah, which is really interesting because it actually activates, and there's some research behind this, a different part of your brain, which you would know from a gaming standpoint, mm-hmm. when you're activating in a space versus passively watching a space. There's actually a different part of your brain that functions and turns on and starts to stimulate, which is also part of this new art form is, and you know, how do we achieve that? And gaming logic, people that play console games or PC games, and that's their primary function of entertainment, tend to actually use a different part of their brain than people that enjoy passive entertainment more. So there's a lot of learning going on in this space.
Right, so what you're doing is all about agency, right? It's all about world building, high quality, it's about just people interacting with other people.
Yeah.
Is there a story in that? Where does
no.
technology?
well, high fidelity, we're creating a virtual reality engine platform from the ground up that is designed to accommodate a lot of people at the same time and like stream all of their expressive movements and the subtleties of your body language, and even like facial motion capture here, that to the point where you do have like the same kind of agency as you would have in reality. Well, pretty darn close to it using today's current technology. And yeah, it's incredible. You know, when you do things like approach someone and take the same kind of social chances you would take in reality, like, you know, violating someone's personal space or...
Like this.
Like this damn thing, yeah. so high fidelity is, it's an incredible technology that is the craziest thing to experience, to take those same social chances and feel the same kind of like vulnerability and fear and elation and surprise that you experience in real life that you could never get from passively consuming media.
So, you're doing more picture, you're trying to do a lot more virtual reality news experiences. How can you play in this space? Are you working with the limitations of live capture images, or are you working around it in some way?
Yeah, so Riot's mission is really to create engaging immersive experiences. We're kind of technology agnostic. We discovered VR early on. We created some of the largest VR library early on. And our whole mission is using technology to tell a story and to get a reaction from the user. For example, when we first started in VR, it was just GoPros and the 3D printed case. We did it for the Nepal earthquake situation that happened in April of last year. And when we normally would do documentaries over certain social issues, we could see a reaction. But when we put the VR headset onto people, people actually started crying and feeling that emotion. And we knew that that was where we had to go. So we switched gears completely and started doing VR. And now AR experiences to really drive that immersive experience.
Okay, so we talk about three things. We talk about presence, in fact.
Their empathy, the idea that it's closely identified, the agency, the fact that we can interact with each other. Is there a future for camera capture in VR, or will it always just be camera capture 360 and CGI in VR? How can we add interactivity and agency to it?
Yeah, so I'm involved in a number of different companies, both from a supporting standpoint, investment standpoint, advisor standpoint, on what we call volumetric or spatial capture, which starts to look at the ability to do what we can do with CGI, with game engines today, which is actually create objects that have physicality and we can move around them and interact with them. The challenge with traditional camera technology like this is two spherical cameras that are stuck in place. So I can lean into it and get closer to it, but it won't react to me, whereas a next generation camera technology will actually allow a spatial sense of that. So it actually has real volume, so you can move around things. It's highly, highly technical. It's highly aspirational, but there are a number of companies that are chewing on this monster, and I believe that we're going to come out the other side with some initial success that won't be the holy grail, and it will take a few cycles and a few generations, just like game engines took 25, 30 years to get to where they are now. And they're pretty remarkable now. But I think the next 20 years are going to be even more remarkable. And I think what you'll end up seeing is a blending of CGI and live action or live capture that will be akin to what we do with major motion pictures today, where things are shot on a green screen and you wouldn't know how often things are faked. Like, you think that it's shot in a real environment, it's actually not shot in a real environment. And I think that's going to happen in virtual reality and augmented reality as well.
So can I ask a question about that? Because, and this is a selfish question, because I live in the world of making up stuff and making up stories and tending to that. So when we talk about news and about, you know, the journalistic side of this, so eventually we get great, you know, volume capture, light field capture, whatever it is, right, that allows us to kind of like explore that space from an arbitrary POV. What do we do in the real world when we're capturing news, when we're capturing real things? What do we unlock when we can do that? Are we trying to build a sense of uncovering detail? Is it about building a sense of empathy? Is it about transferring a sense of identity? How does that work in a world of trying to capture this quote-unquote reality, and you're saying that that's going to become a difficult thing to maybe parse? Yeah. What does that mean from a journalistic point of view?
I really think it's capturing that sense of empathy. When you see a disaster area on TV, you know, you can look at it, you're like, oh, it's sad, and you change the channel. When you're actually there and you see the devastation of what's happening, you can see the scale of it, look around, and you'd be like, oh my God, like, I feel so bad for these people. You can see their faces really close to you. You walk away, they're further away, you come close, you can actually see the pain in their eyes. That's really where in journalism it's going to go to.
Will I believe it? Well, in a world where almost anything is simulatable, will I believe it?
Yeah.
How do you get me to believe it?
I really think that's really the job of the brand. You know, if you're watching CNN, you don't think that you're watching, you know, feature film. You know, I think in that sense, it's really not the technology, it's more about the brand.
Well, let me ask, I'll go back to Scott. What makes something believable? It can be one where it is. It can just be really fuzzy with bad sound, and then not believe it. Do you have any criteria in mind for what it is?
Yeah, I mean, I would say, I mean, this is a personal opinion, but when it engages all your senses, that's when it stops being something you saw on TV and something you actually experienced. It becomes a memory. So it's surround sound. You feel it, you saw it, you felt almost everything, except for smell. So all your senses were activated. I think that's where you start really feeling it.
Okay. And what about, going back to some data in terms of personal space, which is a big issue for me, because we seem to do things in virtual worlds that don't allow this. When you're talking about like identity, people cry in it, is that something that's
me,
anybody.
Yeah, I would say it's more like saying our human experience is sustainable, right?
Yeah.
As the technology becomes better and more real, you're just going to have more experience. So if you saw someone cry, or you saw more disaster zones, or more impactful stories, I think it would just really enrich your life. And instead of you being more cynical about it, being like, oh, this is probably fake, or I don't know if this is real or not. But, you know, only time will tell.
I see virtual reality as potentially being like a new kind of a culture medium, kind of like a petri dish for bacteria to hang out in. I think VR is going to be another space for us to be just as human. And the things that feel real to us, I think will feel real in VR as well. You know, things that are important, things that are human, compassion. Empathy. I think those traits, those things that make us human, will never go away just because we're in a virtual space, you know, rather than a real space.
I wonder if people know some of the legacy of your company. So it comes from some of the group that created something called Second Life. Did anybody here do Second Life? Do you know what Second Life is? A lot, right? So I did it for a little bit, and I was intrigued by it, and it was fascinating, although you were sort of stuck in this little square. That was when your display was this thick, right? And now with High Fidelity, it's sort of taking that concept of Second Life to the next level, where you have this world that you can explore and build upon. It's a pretty fascinating thing, and they're not the only ones that are doing it. There's probably five or six companies I could call that are working on this idea of building social relational experiences. So there's something called VR Chat that just got funded, there's AltSpace, there's Matterport, there's a number of different companies that are dancing around what you guys are doing in High Fidelity, and they're all sort of exploring and doing things. And then, what was it, 2 weeks ago at the Oculus conference, Mark Zuckerberg showed the vision of what Oculus is really working on themselves, where they're really showing and exploring the social dynamics of virtual reality, which at the end of the day is really why they put so much money into the company. It wasn't about gaming. They'll find a good monetizable use case in gaming, but they see it as the next platform for connecting to social experiences. There's a whole bunch of companies dancing around it, which is a good thing.
It's an incredibly fun field, and there's just nothing quite like kind of playing with people, like this very playful sense. This kind of your playful side comes out when you're in VR with other people. And you find yourself going on adventures, you know, it feels kind of like you're in the Goonies or something.
Yeah, totally.
Sharing experiences with people from all around the world, and in an environment like High Fidelity, which is user-generated, totally additive, you're really playing with the fruits of people's imagination. You know, we're not providing like a pre-made chat room for you to go interact with canned experiences. We're saying this is a sandbox where you can make anything. I just can't wait to see the crazy and wonderful things people make and the adventures it's going to take us all on.
I think you're touching on something that's really important, which is, you know, to the point about can we create these emotional experiences or this level of engagement. There's no reason to think that VR is going to be any less successful at creating real, fake emotional experiences than movies are, right? I mean, we know that we go see a movie and it's like, okay, that's a paid actor, written word, you know, saying words that were written by somebody else. You know, we all know that that's fake, yet we still cry, we laugh, we have all those emotional experiences. Because emotional reactions are real, even if the impetus is fake. That's not going to be any different in VR once we kind of get that grammar right. The big difference is going to be what you just talked about, which is the ability to have a different social construct around that experience. We all go to movies, and there is a certain social construct around sitting there facing parallel to a screen. But, you know, there are some movies that are just better if you're watching with a crowd of people than if you're watching by yourselves. The same thing is going to be true in the social dynamic of VR, where you can build that sandbox, but you're building it to play and share and with other people you know or people you don't know, right? That social construct, I think, is going to be totally fascinating. And something that is, I think we were talking about this earlier, is a big piece of VR that is going to become awesome and is less than so today. But obviously you're going to fix that, right? In about 20 minutes or something.
Well, no pressure.
The stuff you're talking about, I've done a lot of those things, and a lot of my compatriots have done a lot of those things. Like, I have done a VR talk show where I was the guest, and there were 50 avatars asking me questions in a VR space. I did VR karaoke, which is just as creepy and terrifying as real karaoke. I've sat in a VR poker room, so if anybody plays poker and you've ever played online poker, you're like, it doesn't really kind of work. When you're in VR, it's like you're really at the casino. It's crazy.
Wow. Do people have tells?
Yeah,
VR?
Absolutely, in their avatars.
Good to know.
Not quite as sophisticated as the real thing. I've driven around in what would be the akin of a Grateful Dead VR with 30 of my friends, and we floated through cosmic space. I've been in VR nightclubs that are quite bizarre, and you can sort of think where that might go. So I kind of get to live a lot of these things first, but I know that this is coming to the mainstream, and it's starting to happen. So it's a pretty fascinating world.
So what I'm hearing is that we're still in the early enthusiasm. Everything is wonderful. Jeremy Bailenson of Stanford says that a good VR experience impacts your brain just like a good real experience, and you can alter someone's worldview through a VR experience, just as you can if they're shocked and have some strong experience in the real world. What safeguards can there be for not having a VR experience that can be damaged? Is that something we have to think about? Or are you going to say innovation should not be constrained, therefore we can't worry about, you know, the zombies attacking a small child?
I think innovation cannot be constrained, regardless of whether it should or should not, it simply cannot. I think that if you had asked the Wright brothers if they had a mechanism to assure that the airplane would be used for good only, you know, there's nothing they can do to prevent it from creating drones that drop bombs or, you know, or anything else like that.
Put me down for anarchy.
Go ahead.
I'm good with anarchy.
He's good with anarchy.
All right.
Yeah. I'll just add to that. I mean, like Caitlin said, I think it should be. We should try our best and to make sure these innovations don't hurt people. The problem is the laws. The regulations always move lightly or slowly than the actual technology. So I think it'll be in people's hands before people know what to do with it.
So. Well, let me ask, and I will be okay with it if you say you can't answer this. But on both the left and the right in this political campaign, there are movies coming out to Netflix and in movie theaters that are pure propaganda. How do you know in Riot, as you're creating these virtual reality experiences, that you're producing something that's news as opposed to editorial?
Yeah, and I think that's a question that all news communications struggle with, is just making sure that there's journalistic integrity, fact-checking, and making sure that, you know, the message that you're sending out to the world is actually researched and verifiable. The good thing about social media and the internet is that everything can be verified. So if you do, you know, present a position or a fact, it can be checked and someone will actually, millions of people will respond to our social media feed and say you're right or you're wrong on that. So it's a little bit democratic in that sense.
We haven't talked at all about augmented reality. Mark Billinger's an Australian case, which is weak and strong. Weak is where you're just projecting images onto a screen like Pokemon. It has no relationship to the world behind it. And strong is where it tries to blend into the world. Focus on weak for a minute, Pokemon type. Is there a future of that, or is that just transitional? Does anyone have an opinion?
There may be a place for it in the world. It's not very compelling as an experience. Overlaid reality is not really reality, right? I don't think anyone's in any danger of assuming that Pokemon Go is an augmented reality, right? Especially because the world is only presented through this rectangle. Right? This is a very, very weak lens through which to view the world and have any sense of reality. So I would gladly welcome the, what'd you call it, the strong augmented reality? I would gladly welcome the strong to come as quickly as possible.
So I guess I would be a little contrarian to that in the sense that I've been sort of tracking the dynamic of what that means and how technology becomes an interesting enabler for scavenger hunts, which is what this Pokemon thing is. It's just a very sophisticated and very well-formed and tied to a really viral IP scavenger hunt. And when it started to blow up virally and people started talking about it, I was like, you guys know that this is new, right? Like, this has been done many, many, many times before. And it captured small viral audiences. And by the way, there's another one that captured a massive viral audience called geocaching. And Pokemon Go is just an evolution of geocaching. And if anybody doesn't know what geocaching is, go to your phone when you get home. If you have kids, do some geocaching on your phone. It's a lot of fun. It's a worldwide scavenger hunt that you just use the lens of your phone to move around the world and find things and sign a little log and do things. And it's a great social activity that you can do. So those guys just expanded upon that theme, and I just thought it was just well executed. To me, it shows that craftsmanship matters a lot.
I think you're right. It's a great scavenger hunt. It's a lot.
It just works well for my scavenger.
I was going to say, it's a great scavenger. It's a better scavenger hunt than it is an augmented reality.
Yeah, it's not really augmented reality. It's a slight mixed reality sense to it, but it works enough that it became viral and it became magnetic. So I think there's something to be said for what becomes the game and why.
I would say it comes down to definitions, because I think augmented reality is the true definition of the word augment. The world around me is going to enhance and add to. So it's adding geolocation information as opposed to visual or audio information. So it's still AR, but it's like really weak AR. But on the point of, one attendee a little earlier, I want to ask Scott, theme parks are essentially blended reality experiences. As we move into this world of blended reality all around us, how are you thinking of connecting the location-based entertainment to the daily life of people who are fans? And anybody else can answer this?
Well, I'll say a couple of things. One, you know, I think actually when you think about theme parks or just the Disney parks that I'll speak to, you know, I mean, in many ways, that was the first virtual reality, an artificially crafted environment that's built around a story that invites you to come in and decide whether you want to be a voyeur or a participant in a story, in this built environment. Now, you know, back in the day, that wasn't done through code. It was done through concrete and 2x4s, right? I'm still largely done that way today, although now there's new technology through which we are kind of exploring other things like agency, like how deeply we ask you or invite you to become a character. All those things are starting to happen. To your specific question of how does that blend with my daily life, I guess what I would say is the idea of strong augmented reality in a built environment is something that is a very compelling notion, right, to me and to others, right? Because there's always going to be a benefit that we have in our purpose-built environment. It's going to be great experiences you can get at home. You're going to want to consume data all the time. You're going to want to, because there's going to be freshness, right, fresh data. There's going to be an opportunity to hang out with your best friends all the time. Those are always going to be cool things. And then there's going to be those opportunities to go into stories at home. But there'll always be a limit into how much we can actually activate all of your senses and to really make it a truly immersive experience. When we purpose-built the location, when we purpose-built the environment, we can add all the bells and whistles, it allows us to go so much deeper and to make those connections with characters or those story universes in a way you can't do at home, because we can do the smell, right? We can do the full haptics. We can do all that stuff. I'm not saying we know how to do full body haptics, that nobody does. But when we figure those things out, and those are our things we're working on, we'll be creating places and invitations for you to truly, truly dive deep into these story universes and inhabit these story universes, or even inhabit these characters in a way that is different than you can do at home, but potentially more compelling than you can do at home. But will also be limited in scale just because of the fact that you can't, you can't live there.
Well, I mean, appropriate tools for the appropriate environment, right? So, I just happen to know Disney has a Pete's Dragon in AR, which says, Pete's Dragon is hiding by the couch. And you point your camera phone around the house when it sees a couch, and it's the dragon behind it, right? So, you're actually talking about something I think you want to get into, which was the narrative space design and history of it, and how it's getting into theme parks.
Well, I think there's no, in virtual reality, or even augmented or mixed reality, but let's say this virtual reality, you're crafting that environment, right? We're talking about a physical, the perception of a physical space. And one of the things that we have learned through the work we do in parks is, there is a certain narrative structure for space, like the cinematics of space. There's a language, architects know this, spatial designers know this. You can craft experience and story and emotional responses through the manipulation of people's experience of space and the space around them. That is going to be 100% part of the toolkit for the virtual reality environmental designer, is to hack our perceptions and our emotional reactions to the perception and reaction to spatial experiences. That's something that every VR experience that's going to be not just representational of a real world or a journalistic, trying to represent a true reality. Anybody who's crafting a narrative space is going to have to learn that language, right? The cinematics of space.
I have to agree with you on that. And I think we're going to find, all of this language that people have created from architecture. There's a book, The Poetics of Space, Bachelard or something, that deals with this. And I think we're going to see this grammar that architects have been using come into just kind of a common grammar, just like, people talk about lenses and, f-stops or whatever on their cameras. I think architecture and space is going to become a casual medium, and I think we're going to see it explored deeply. And it's really cool because, if you think about it, the resources that you need to design and express yourself in space, this has always been a very exclusive area. You have to be part of this very small, tight group of architects who are educated. You have, very technical, and you also have to have access to resources to build things and money. We're going to see people constructing, sandcastles or things with the casualness that you used to make a sandcastle, but to make things that we can't even fathom.
Well, and the most popular game in the world is testament to that, because Minecraft is essentially by far the most used piece of gaming technology in the world, and it's all about world building. And when you see what some of these kids have built in their Minecraft universes, it's mind-blowing.
Oh yeah, I'm embarrassed.
Yeah, it's quite amazing.
Oh, man,
but it's all just using the tools, and of course now there's Minecraft in VR, and people are using it and functioning in VR that way, both on a professional and amateur level, and it's pretty amazing.
But Minecraft has a structure and tools. Do you think, as we get into the virtual world building, can it be unstructured, or do you need to define the rules of the game before you launch it?
So you have things like Tilt Brush, which is already a sort of a leader in the space as a creative tool. You have Oculus as a medium, and there's 20 or 30 other different creation tools. There's a wonderful little startup doing something called Mindshell, which is like taking Minecraft and imagine if you could actually throw characters together in a little story and push the go button, and kids can do this. So that idea of freeform creation and virtual reality is a big part of where the universe is going.
And I think it also depends on the type of experience you're designing. So if you're doing a world-building experience, I think, you know, letting everyone go around and do whatever they want is great. If you have a narrative, though, let's say there's a movie about this panel right now, and you're in VR, you can walk around the screen and do whatever you want. Let's say you decide to walk into that corner over there near that speaker. I think it's up to the platform and the content creator to kind of use the technology to guide you back to where things are actually happening. So the issue is designing that language to bring people back. When you're doing linear and you're on TV, you can always bring the most important aspects of it. But if people can walk around and do whatever they want in VR, that's the biggest problem, is how to direct the attention.
I think that's not the problem. I think that's the biggest opportunity, that you can do whatever you want. Go ahead. This is why I plug High Fidelity some more. But High Fidelity, our platform is open source because we want to see people making all kinds of weird creative tools that we can't even imagine. Like having an open platform, we're hoping that people will wind up making tools to accomplish a creative project that they're working on, and the tool isn't yet available, so they offer it. And then they kind of bring this in, it sort of enriched the toolscape. Ooh, I just made that up. Toolscape.
TM.
Yeah.
Well, this is actually a really controversial question. Is VR a medium for storytelling, or is it for experiences and story making by the visitor, by each visitor as they go through?
I think that's a false binary decision, because I think it is absolutely a forum for storytelling it'll be a continuum, right? There'll be some stories that are told by story makers who are making these stories that want you to experience them in a certain didactic way, all the way to the sandbox, whether it's Minecraft or High Fidelity, where you're making it all up from scratch. And in between, there's going to be a whole variety of things like, okay, here's a story. Here's a story system, right? Here's a story system that's going to come to life. You were kind of saying this before, right? Here's a story system that's going to come to life, but the only thing that's missing is you, and you can decide how to influence that story. You can influence how to see that story. The people around you have a role to influence that story. I don't think it's either or. It is yes and.
Yeah, it can definitely be a sandbox with a story. So, allow you to go do whatever you want in that room, but at some point when you're bored, it's time to go on to the next chapter for that experience. And it's exciting to see what's going to happen. It's a good mix.
And I still just want to hear your thoughts more on live capture VR. Is there a broad future in that, or is that going to be niche and everything really has to be CGI so that you can have all the other characteristics of VR?
No, I think there's a huge opportunity for live action capture. I think things like volumetric technology will give us unprecedented access to things that we've never seen before. For example, imagine if you go to your favorite concert and capture that in volumetric. You could literally walk around Beyonce. I'm not saying that's my favorite concert, but you could walk around Beyonce and be there. And that's something that people just can't do at all in the regular medium that we have right now. And for sports events, being able to do an instant replay and actually see where the football went and walk around that's incredible. And I don't think that's going to go away. It's only going to get better in time.
almost seems like we ought to have a different term for these two types of VR, because like what you're describing is totally awesome and valid as a form of reporting or sharing and experiencing reality, or like cinematic storytelling in the older sense. Quite different though from VR as I see it. I almost think we should call this like spatial journalism, spatial video.
It's definitely a world where you can change what's gonna happen.
Right.
And in your world, you can definitely do whatever you want. This is more like, I want to experience a thing that's happened. I can't change it, but I want to see all angles of it.
Yeah,
for sure.
Okay, so this brings us to the whole idea of engagement and user interface and user experience. So can each of you think about or discuss a recent user interface experience or design that impressed you and you said, oh yeah, this is probably going to be key to the future experience? Because we've been talking about, control pads and keyboards and things like that. Where do you see it heading? And I don't mean the perfect answer for the future, but what do you see that you think has potential?
Well, I can start there when you guys can add in. I think the minute we move away from the last generation of user interface, which is either a keyboard or a gamepad or an A, B, and X button and a couple of click buttons here, to actually using your hands in a more naturalistic way, number one, it broadens your audience massively, because you're not now a gamer that can play this game. You can sort of do it at any level of the human sort of interaction. So where the three main sort of tethered systems are now delivering on the promise of that is the Vive was first with their controllers, which still are a little controllery, but they lock into your hand positions and you can control things. So when you're doing tilt brush, you're not using a controller to paint. You're painting with a brush and a palette and you move around, and that's the user interface is much more naturalistic. On the Vive side, on the Oculus side, they have the touch controllers, which are a little more hands pleasant. They start to kind of get lost once you put the headset on, you don't really feel them because of the way they're designed. And a really good experience is what Epic Games designed last year, which is called Bullet Train, where it's a very active sort of shooter thing, but it has a storyline that plays into it, which we can talk more about that, because I personally am one of those guys that doesn't get hung up on story and narrative and interactivity. I think it's all blended in the same thing. And I think that Bullet Train has just as a valid story as a movie does. It's just different. And I was in an interesting sort of heated argument about talking about the hero's journey on one of the most popular pieces of storytelling of the last 40 years, and it's called Pac-Man. So it's maybe a story for another day, but think about it for a second, it's the hero's journey. I'll just leave it there. It's a story, and it's not because the game is so good, it's not because the game is so good, it's because the story is so good, and you got absorbed in the story of saving this little character and moving into love with love. But that's a story for another day. As you're talking about hand movement, I think it's the holy grail. And in the next level of that, you won't actually use anything physical. You'll just use your hands. And there's a bunch of different companies like Leap Motion that's doing some interesting stuff, and a bunch of companies that are experimenting with just tracking your hands so refined that I could do all of these things just like I do in the real world in virtual reality or augmented reality without having an apparatus. And that's kind of where it's headed. The modern adaptation of this Bullet Train thing is what just came out of Oculus a couple weeks ago from that called Robo Recall. And it's one of the most intense haptic experiences that I've ever had a chance to play. And I encourage you all to do it and see where it's going. It's story, it's gaming, it's intense, and your whole physical body gets into it.
That's something we're also doing a lot of. High fidelity is designed to be interacted with predominantly with your hand controllers. So the Oculus Touch and the Vive hand controllers are supported at the moment. And one thing I've been doing is just kind of replicating a lot of like physics-based physical activities that that everyone has muscle memory of, like things like bowling, tetherball, mini golf, and punching a punching bag. And I've been working on simulating these experiences such that you can share it with other people so we can be, batting a tether ball around. But I would say that one of the most interesting user interface experiences, maybe it's just the context more than one thing that I find that's really interesting is just kind of interfacing with sets of data in new ways. We had an internal hackathon, and everyone in High Fidelity created like a project. And our graphics engineer, he's a big voxels guy, and his wife was pregnant, and she had some really thorough ultrasound data. And somehow, I don't know how you obtain point cloud data of your uterus, but we had the data set. And for his hackathon submission, his wife's uterus was floating there in 3D space and moving. And, it's volumetric and it's crude, it's point cloud data and it's black and white. And me and my colleagues, we were all just standing there in this virtual space, and you can kind of fly around in High Fidelity, kind of walk around. And, you can turn and look at someone and, say, hey, come over here. And there was this moment where we were like, can you go in? Maybe see, and it was an interesting way to experience data. And we flew in there. It still felt funny.
So we've done similar things to that as one of the pro bono projects on the medical side that we're working with. We work with UCLA on the neurosurgery side. And there's a doctor there named Dr. Neil Martin who got, he's very high tech and he got very absorbed and interested in virtual reality. And he took the CT scans and the MRIs of the brain and he's able to actually view them spatially in virtual reality so he can rehearse his surgeries in a more precise way and see what that data is and things that on a flat screen, even a 3D screen, you don't know what's behind it, but he can get behind the brain and see the actual tumor and what he's got to remove. And this sort of undiscovered journey was, it's extremely valuable for him and his students as a training mechanism and a rehearsal mechanism, but it also became a therapeutic thing for the patients. So he would start showing the patients, this is what your brain looks like, and here's this little problem area that we have to take out. And the more visual data they could gather, the more relaxed they were. They understood in a more intimate way what was going to happen than just a flat screen. And he says it's remarkable the level of comfort that they come back with and say, I have a new faith in this, I have a new trust in the technology, I understand more what they're going to do to me now. Which I think is a powerful way to talk about interfacing and all that.
Scott.
Yeah, I guess the thing that I would just kind of comment on, in terms of this user interface thing, is something that we've been saying, which is, so much of what we've talked about is the ability for us to engage and participate in either the storytelling, participate in the social contracts, or participate by having more autonomy over our point of view on real world experiences. But there's a way in which that is all still very, very much a broadcast and mediated experience, which is all of this is really mostly coming through our eyeballs and our ear holes. Are those medical terms, I believe? Ear holes. And we're not really able to use the body as part of this dialogue, right? So the big, shortcoming today, yes, I can use these controllers to kind of like the end effectors, if you will, in VR. There's even great ways to track hands and fingers. I did a thing last week where the hand tracking was so good that I just found myself like an infant staring at my hands and completely ignoring the stuff I was supposed to be doing. And I was just like, oh my God, this is amazing! The colors! But the haptic side of that, the feedback loop, right? The conversation that you're having as a human in this space is incomplete when it's just limited to what you can see and what you can hear. And so that is really, really the thing that I think that, I mean, obviously a lot of people are thinking about this, it's not a new idea, but this is something that I feel I'm most excited about solving that really, really hard problem so that it can become a fully, fully immersive and believable human experience, not just a CG kind of visual experience.
And I just want to echo the thoughts of everyone. I think the user interface is going to start going away. There will be no concept. I mean, you just basically, if you know how to use your hands, you know how to use whatever product is going to come up through AR or VR. But like Scott said, you know, until you have that feedback loop, it's never going to be a complete experience. And you know, unless you start wiring into your neural system, I don't really know how that's going to be done like perfectly. But I do see examples, even in our small projects of AR, where you start seeing the user interface going away. For example, we'll bring the Elle magazine cover to life, and you point the phone at it, the cover comes to life, you start watching video on it, and then you tell the person, you know, you can actually zoom in and see more of this, and their first instinct is just to do this, right? And I'm like, no, it's actually like the real world. You've got to bring your phone closer to zoom in. So the interface is going away. Like all the constructs you have about how things work, how to zoom in, how to interact with something, it's all going to go away, and it's going to go back to the things that you know how to do. So that's the positive end of it, in my mind.
I always like what Shigeru Miyamoto said about the Rubik's Cube being like a perfect example of an interface for a complicated system that you don't really need to think too much about to use. You just put it in your hands and you're just like, oh, you know, you figure it out.
Well, you can figure it out.
I always took it apart and put it back together.
So a good user interface needs to be intuitive. I'm curious to know, you all talked about your hands. So much work is going into voice, artificial intelligence, and voice recognition. Is there a reason why no one talked about anything other than a legacy tool, like a game controller trying to get your hand motion? Think of other things like your voice or your eyes stare or some sort of breathing thing?
Well, High Fidelity originally, we actually started developing a platform before consumer VR was a thing. about a year before Oculus kind of hit the news. And we were working with depth cameras that could read facial expressions. And the first version of High Fidelity was going to be more about like streaming the very, like the subtleties of your facial expressions. And we actually got it to be really good, you know. Like every little subtlety, like just the smallest fraction of an eyebrow lift or something. We were using face shift technology, which is, you know, popular facial motion capture software, and it was so effective. They were bought by Apple and kind of disappeared into the Apple hole, into the core. And Oculus came out and we decided we were going to sort of pivot. But we still have all that in there, in our engine, so we're just waiting for the hardware to be able to support it. There's a company called Binary VR, which is going to be putting a camera on the bottom of your HMD to watch your mouth, and that will be working. We've already implemented that, so your, you know, the expressiveness of your mouth will come through. We also have done the same with eye tracking, although there aren't really HMDs on the market yet that support eye tracking. We took an Oculus Rift and mounted a very, very expensive eye tracking camera from a company that makes gear for LASIK eye surgery equipment, and that works really well. So we just need to wait for the hardware to come around. And the same with hand controllers, you know. There are glove-like hand controllers which can work very well with High Fidelity already. We're just waiting for them to hit the market. I'm kind of surprised it hasn't happened yet.
So let me put your future hat on. Say it's 5 years from now, all this stuff is in the market, it's all working beautifully. What is the future of shopping mall going to be? Will people have a reason to come together in a civic place, or will it all be virtualized? What do you think a mall will be? A physical mall, or a physical space like that? Where do you think it's headed?
I don't think the physicality of real physicality goes away. I think it becomes more specialized and more unique and more extras. I think you can, you know, so that's my job as Fox, is pretending to be a futurist. I call myself futurist in training. But really, what you do as a futurist is you look into the past to see where the future is going. You're really a pastist. And if you, that's what you really do. So if we look at social media as a platform of how people stay connected today, and their human behavior doesn't change, but it shifts a little bit, right? So these micro shifts that become big shifts, and then become bigger shifts, where a fairly good portion of your day is connecting with people, and we use different conceits called email, right? So I don't have to pick up the phone as many times as I used to, because I use email now, and that's the order of the day, I use text. Or I use social media in some platform, and if you're under the age of 16, email to you looks like a formal letter or a phone call, because you're like, why the hell would you use that? That's a ridiculous device. I have something much more nimble and much more effective, and I use Snapchat, right? Which is why it became so big, and it becomes coveted, because it hits into a certain vein of how people want to communicate. And every generation sort of moves that ball forward. I think all you have to do is look at the popularity of Amazon and how many people buy whatever they buy every year now on Amazon, and how they don't have to go to a shopping mall anymore. And all you have to do is talk to mall operators, and they'll tell you the drama of their lives and how they're trying to rejigger their worlds to make a shopping mall more of a destination, an entertainment and a viewing destination. When you know you can just get it all and click a button, but you still have to experience it in some fashion in the real world. The potential promise and or potential horror for manufacturers of product in VR is when you can simulate all of that. When I can look at my toy and I can experiment with it and I can play around with it in VR before I buy it, then I really don't have to go to the mall, right? So what does the mall become? Does the mall become an entertainment center? This is some of the stuff that we're experimenting with, thinking about, working on. Does the mall become a socialization place, a gathering place? When concerts get so good that you can simulate being at the concert, and it's just easier than really going to the concert and plus spending money, it becomes more of an edge case, which is already today. That's not the future. That's what's happening right now. It's hard to gather yourself to go to the real thing. So if you get a simulation on television, if you're a sports fan, you likely watch more sports on television than you do go into the actual game. Now, half a generation ago, going to the real game was way better than watching on television. Now, someone would argue, a lot of people would argue, that watching on television is way better than going to the real thing, other than the human connection factor, the feeling of being in the game, right? But if virtual reality and augmented reality can bring you that much closer, then the going to the real game becomes more and more of an edge case. We call it the Broadway of the world, right? So this is something that cinema is dealing with now, right? It's becoming more of an edge case. And you kind of got to constantly think about that as you look at where your entertainment dollars are being spent. And as a movie studio, part of my job is to sort of keep looking around the next corner at how I'm going out of the house relevant and staying in the house relevant in different ways.
So Eric is our resident millennial. What do you think of all this? Do you see a future down the road where you want to come together with the workplace? I mean, I remember the 212 at New York in 614, 617 at Boston. Thank you. But does place have any meaning in your future?
I think less and less, but one important aspect of it is that haptic feedback. Until that's kind of solved, you'll never be able to go to a store and try on a blazer and see how it feels and things like that. Until that issue is solved, I think we've started solving a lot of other issues, like seeing the store, seeing the space and everything, having your friends there. That's all going to be solved in the future. I still don't quite see how we're going to solve feeling the material or any kind of experience that requires like force feedback. So I guess until that's solved, for me, I'd still go on and try on things. I've been rather supportive of them.
I guess, in some way, if you look at VR as just a different kind of medium that has its strengths and weaknesses, it's a better way to look at it, because, you know, why animate a film if you could tell the same story, you know, as a radio show? You know, why retool something for the medium that isn't best suited for it? So things like shopping for clothing and stuff like that, I mean, it makes sense that you'd want to do that in person. what I find very exciting about VR is all the things that that are not possible in this world that will become possible there. I think that's where the power lies.
Yeah, I would just add, look beyond VR, you know, the idea of an exciting idea, it's exciting to me anyway, is looking beyond VR and to mixed reality, or maybe better to call it enhanced reality, right? Which is a version of the real world, but augmented in some way that I want to, you know, that it brings me pleasure, or it brings me service, or it brings me information, or potentially story if I want that, right? But it is not an overlay onto the real world, but it's woven into my real world. I don't think it's about VR replacing physical space. I think it's about alternate realities, virtual, mixed, augmented, weaving themselves into my reality that allows them to live in that space with me. So, you know, when I try on that blazer, I'm actually at a real place trying on that blazer, but I may have my best friend with me who happens to live in the 617 or in the 212. And they're like, dude, you look awesome on that. I'm like, thanks.
Exactly.
Have you seen this, yeah. This, just speaking of touching fabrics, this robotic arm that can pull out various surfaces and hold them up to you while you're in VR? Mm-hmm. You guys, I just pictured Disney's got one. Can I have one, please?
The ability, well, yeah, I can't. Yeah, I can't.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I really got one.
We have time for a few questions from the audience. If anyone has questions? Sure.
Oh, I've heard rumors that the Magic League team is working with one of the companies that might be represented up there. Any comments that you can make?
We don't want to ask any.
Well, I can say, I don't know which company you're talking about, but we have a partnership we've announced with Magic Leap, so I'm cool talking about that. And it is, you know, we have, as an entertainment, as a content company, as a sports company, as a broadcasting company, as a news company, we have lots of partnerships, we have lots of people that we're talking to about platforms that we think might be interesting, ways of telling stories that might be interesting, storytellers that might be interesting. So in some ways, the folks at Magic Leap are a combination of a lot of those things. You can think of them as a technology, you can think of them as a platform, you can think of them as a collection of storytellers. So we've started some exploration with what that might mean. Obviously, it's really early days for them, and it's really early days for the medium. So not much to report about where that might go. I mean, the whole point is the whole point is not knowing where it's going to go and kind of figuring it out and kind of saying, you know, in some ways it's about kind of just playing the game of, hey, what's cool? I don't know if that answers your question. I don't actually know if that answered your question. Or
It did answer the question. Is it Presidio based?
So we have a couple of different things going and a couple of different area codes. We do, I mean,
that's not a secret. That's,
yeah,
that's public.
I don't think it's a secret that we have something up at the Presidio.
415.
At the 415.
What?
But that is one place we have stuff, and, you know, obviously Magic Leap, there may be somebody here from Magic Leap, that, you know, it's a big company, they have stuff all over the place, and,
Another question? Is that it?
Do you think Westworld's an analogy for a lot of the stuff you guys are talking about?
I do.
You mean
the original?
The original or the new one?
Yeah, I do.
I forgot the original, but go for either one.
I 100% do. I think one of the fortunes I got once that lives in my wallet is, in time, the impossible becomes possible. And all of this is hunting its way towards a future where these kind of experiences start to become so real. Like when you start to put a little bit of the future lens on what we're doing today versus what we'll do as soon as just 5 to 7 years from now, the stuff that we're using today that we call virtual reality, these boxes on our faces, will not have that form factor, will not be that resolution, will not be that level of sophistication. Everything will change radically if the continued desire for it and impetus, and both on an economic and creative side, continues to show its strength. And I don't see that anything that comes out of the world of H.G. Wells or Westworld or anything that has been created by fantastic artists that see the future, you know, Michael Crichton or anybody like that, could become as real as we want it to be.
I agree. I think we're going to see things, you know, a lot of people talk about Ready Player One, Snow Crash, and a lot of this other very fun and delightful and adventurous virtual reality kind of metaverse-based fiction. And I think what we're going to find is going to just blow our minds, and it's going to be something far more imaginative than anything. And we're going to see such a diversity of experiences and so many different like aspects of human creativity come out. It's kind of hard to fathom.
Well, just in the last 3 years, just seeing, you know, where we've gone from 3.5, 4 generations of technology in just a couple of years, and knowing some of the stuff that we're involved in, you know, on the secret side of our world, the labs, and what we're seeing that's coming that everyone will get a chance to see relatively soon, the level of software, the level of experience that are being created is massive leaps forward in just a couple of years as people start to get a sense that this is going to be a commercial market. In the next few years, we're going to look back at this as the early days of, like, we're kind of in the Pong era, if you can believe that.
The what?
The Pong era, like the very beginnings of what's possible here. Or I say the brick cell phone era.
The brick phone era.
And if you like this world, I recommend Dark Mirror.
Dark Mirror is another
Or
the original Twilight Zone. Yeah. I think the idea, you know, the original Westworld, the 1973 version, was kind of a cautionary tale about technology, I think, but the current incarnation, and we'll see where it goes over time, but it actually speaks, I think, very much to, I forgot who asked it, might have been you, Phil, who asked the question about what are the limits we should put on VR? What are the protections, right? I mean, because the current questions that are raised in Westworld are more about, you know, what is morality in a virtual environment? What is that? What is the morality of identity look like in a virtual environment, in a consequence-free environment? And so maybe the question is virtual reality a consequence-free environment? Should it be, right? And I think you'd be
which
answered.
Which is actually why I asked the question, because Second Life evolved into photography and criminality and other things.
Right.
I mean, these issues aren't in the medium. These are in the people.
Sure.
And
what? I'm shocked to hear that.
It's in the people. I mean, it's just going to follow us wherever we go, and it could be amplified or muted or, yeah.
Yeah,
people are just going to be.
You
are all horrible people with dirty minds.
Someone way smarter than me said, if you're going to build a ship, you can expect you're going to have some shipwrecks. So with any new technology, as it starts to evolve, it'll go this way, it'll go this way. And if you're an optimist, you believe that humanity will win out. But every single talk I do always goes into this. Is it a dystopian universe or a utopian universe that VR will bring to us, AR will bring to us, or immersive technologies in some fashion will bring to us? And because I tend to be an optimist, I tend to believe that humanity finds a way. That, yes, there are always edge cases where there will be shipwrecks and there will be problems and everything new, including our phones.
Yeah.
But for the most part, people tend to do good things, not bad things, is what we tend to say.
David. Hi, I'm David Nelson from Mark Wallace's Mixed Reality Lab at USC. Thank you, analysts, for sharing with us. So all of the virtual reality experiences we're talking about are intrinsically experienced from the first person, right? The nature of the medium. And there's a lot of talk about storytelling. So my question is, how do you think this might impact the idea of a protagonist in a narrative piece?
I'm not sure it's true that all VR is told from a first-person perspective.
Not necessarily, but it is the propensity of VR these days. But I don't think it always has to be that way.
Do you think, I mean, yeah.
I mean,
true?
A lot of what we do, it's not necessarily from the first-person experience, but it is an experience of someone standing nearby. You're not necessarily changing the story. You're either viewing it from someone's point of view, whether that's the first person or a camera that's nearby. You could have this camera right here. It's not the first person experience, but it's as if you were sitting right here and watching us speak. So we do see a lot of first person experiences. But yeah, to answer your question, I think that's going to change. I think in the future, it's really going to be up to the person viewing the content to see which storyline they want to follow. You could be the protagonist, you could be the villain. It's really up to you. And as story makers, it's up to us to give you that option.
Well, and do you have the limitations of one of the characters? Are you omniscient? Do you have the ability to change your points of view and perspectives on the fly? Or once you make that choice, are you locked into seeing it from a certain point of view? I mean, I think those are all choices that authors of these experiences are going to be able to play with in the same way that a cinematographer today can play with what lens, you know, and how you shoot something. Do you move the camera as a set of camera? All those things are going to become part of the grammar of these experiences. And frankly, I think it's like super interesting to figure that stuff out.
When we built the Martian experience, there was a certain obviousness to the fact that it made sense as a first-person journey because that is the story. So if the story lends itself to that, VR has a propensity to go that way. If the story lends itself to not that, then I think you can explore other conceits and other ways to attack it. But for the most part, what I see today is the obvious fall in position is I want to be this, I want to do this, I want to be the agent of change. So because the story was written that way for us with the Martian, it was the obvious choice. It was essentially the only choice because we had to be true to the book and true to the movie. But I don't think that's 100% always going to be the case.
I can't wait to see what people do with it. There's going to be so many new new directions that people will be able to take this. I'm sure we're going to see a whole diversity of storytelling systems and ways of being the protagonist or watching the protagonist. I think it's just going to be phenomenal. Probably going to see it explored in many different ways.
Yeah. We've hit 8 o'clock. I think we have 10 minutes, so please join me in thanking the panel. Thank you. Thank you.
I raise a glass to the camera.
Do I drop the water?